Jimmy Sirrel will always be a legend at Notts County. You know more about Jimmy than just about everybody else connected with Notts. What was he like to work with? What was he like as a man?
My relationship with Jimmy was very, very good in the sense, and in one sense in particular. Here I am, to most people, green, wet behind the ears, and he wheels me in and says, he's number one. And then he takes a back seat in a supporting manner, never once wishing to, as it were, even intimate that you do realize, all of you, that it's really me that's doing this. Quite the contrary. And in fact, in that respect, he was also protective. Because, and that was shown when we played down at Leighton Orient, after the game, out of the blue, he said to me, he basically said, look, come with me and deal with the press conference. So I go, yeah, all right, no problem. So I follow him up the stairs. We go into the room. We get into the room. In those days, the journalists stood around you. And the bigger the club or the smaller the club, the more of them they were. On this occasion, because we were doing well in the league, there was a lot of journalists. And also, because then it was the written word. There was no other way of translating news out there. So it's the written word. So there were journalists, every newspaper, big or small, would have somebody somewhere. And so I'm asked this question. He introduces me as the young coach. Will answer the questions today. So I step forward, and the first question is, Mr. Wilkinson, tell us about, and it was about the way we play. Yeah. We played. You've got a different style. Can you tell us something about that? And I go, and before I have fit, he's jumped in front of me, and he says, young man, I suggest, if you want to know answers to things like that, you get a bleep bleep coach education at Lillyshall. And then he turns around, takes me by the arm, and says, and walks us out of the room. So that's the end of press conference. Which could happen any time with Jimmy, in terms of he epitomizes a phrase I've come to love, which is, if you're not afraid to think it, don't be afraid to say it.
Another wonderful story. I love this one as well. About Friday morning was choosing the team and putting it up on the wall. And you always pick the team, but Jimmy had that little, I don't know what you would call it, quirk or whatever. He wanted to type the team out, didn't he? So just talk me through what happened, because his typewriting skills weren't the best.
Well, as you know, in those days, there was a medium for transporting news, which was a machine out of wheat, which spilled a sheet of paper with typewritten on it. And that sheet of paper could be anything from a foot long to 20 foot, depending on who you were and what you did with it. Now, what Jimmy would do, those pieces of paper He wouldn't let those go to waste. This is Jimmy. He wouldn't let that go to waste. Now, everywhere else I've been, they've had a team sheet. But he wouldn't let that go to waste. So he would want to write the team down on paper first before he typed it. And he'd write it on that. So to be written on the back of that, he'd say, Coach, what is your team today? Have you made, change your mind and all that? So I would then tell him the team and he would start to type it. And it would be one finger, and then I'll guarantee at least three or four times he'd get so far down and he'd make a spelling mistake. And then he'd curse, rip that out, bin that, and we'd start again.
Getting past Avramovich was probably a challenge, wasn't it?
So it was, and it was just one of, it was a ritual. Was it an annoying ritual? Well, yeah, at the beginning, because it was, you could spend 20 minutes on a 2-minute job. But at the end of the day, it was allowing him to do one of those jobs which he associated with Fridays and management. You know, so what?
Jimmy grew up in quite a poor area of Glasgow, had a strong working class mentality, similar possibly to Sir Alex. And you tell me a story that kind of encapsulated his working, or his ethics to put himself under pressure. When he came in one morning to tell you we'd got another mortgage.
Yes.
Go on.
It was Monday morning. It was well into the season. Things were going well. And I walked in on the Monday morning. And normal chit-chat, what are you going to do to him? And he said, then he mentioned the result, and he said something like, young man, I was thinking yesterday, and I was thinking that life is very comfortable at the moment. In fact, too, be comfortable for me. So I've decided to put myself back under pressure again. So I'm thinking, oh, what's he going to say now? Is he going to step back into the job I'm doing? Is he, what's he going to do? I said, oh, right. So what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to take out another mortgage. I said, pardon? I'm going to take out another mortgage. Basically, he got a mortgage on his house. And he was quite able to pay that mortgage. And it was probably counterproductive for him to do what he was doing. But he thought, if I increase the mortgage at the bank, I'll have to pay out more each week. And his interpretation was, so I'll have the pressure to do that. And I walked out scratching my head thinking, right, okay. I don't know. It might have been to try to give him a reason to tell his wife, Kath, that she had to be careful with the housekeeping.
I remember when I left Leicester to set my own business up, and I spoke to Martin O'Neill about it, and he used a very good phrase. People tell you these things, don't they? And phrases sometimes stick with you. Yeah. Martin said to me, never be afraid to put yourself under pressure.
Yes.
And I think there's an element of that maybe with Jimmy.
Yeah, that was Jimmy.
But from that story. Okay, so we're now going in to the top flight football. presumably this is what you'd aspired towards as fans. If I could go into a time machine, H.G. Wells, and wind the clock back to any year of my life, I would go back to August 1981. I'm switching places with you, Sheffield and Nottingham. I'm going to be a journalism student in Sheffield. Notts County are in the top flight of English football. I'm going to do every game. I'm going to love it. Yeah? First game, away, Aston Villa, who've just won the Football League. So we're all off we go on the supporters train and all the rest of it. And before the game, because Villa hadn't won it at home or something, Trevor Christie tells the story, they ran round the pitch, didn't they? Parading the Football League trophy from the previous season. Now, I'm not going to say that was a red rag to a bull, but that was a bit of a black and white flag to a bull. And presumably that took care of your a few words you might have needed to say just before kickoff, yeah?
Yeah, plus the fact that, you know, it's first time back in the big league. We were away. Villa had done what they'd done. The ground's full. As a manager, on occasions like that, and every team's different, all circumstances are different, but you don't have to say much. I mean, I had experience in my team, in our team, so you don't have to say much. And we had done a lot of work in the build-up to that game, particularly on set pieces and on a couple of things I'd noticed. So in that sense, we've got nothing to lose. And I always preached, why are set pieces important? I'll tell you why they're important. The stats tell you how important they are and so on and so forth. But just as important is the fact that I said it in particular, it's an away game when you're playing someone and they're, it's a Liverpool or whatever, and in the first 20 minutes you're struggling to actually stay in the game. You only need one corner kick, one free kick, and then forget how many points they got the season before, forget how well they've been playing and so on and so forth. That one corner kick, that one free kick can quieten that crowd for 10 minutes. And at that time, they're not better than us. They're not better than us. They might be better in free play and so on and so forth, but they're not better than us. My centre-half can head just as well as theirs, etc., etc. Pace doesn't really matter. If it's a free kick that's going into the box, if it's a corner kick that's going into the box, if it's a long throw, all of those qualities become non-valuable because we've got the ball. They can't affect the person who's going to deliver. We know where it's going to go, whereas they might not. And we know where we're going to be when it is delivered. So, as I say about man-to-man marking, the opponent's in charge, and that's the point I made to the players, that if we get set pieces around the box and they are marking man-to-man, we're in charge. Their markers are run where we run. So we've got to be, all that we've got to be very good at, and we have people who can do this, is one, delivery, and then two, foreknowledge. So if you've got people you can rely on to deliver into those areas, and if you've got a team that's well-drilled in actually getting the right person or persons into those areas at the right time, it's an even playing field. And that game was such an example.
It's interesting. And again, for our younger viewers and listeners, you know, my son, other people of that generation. England had a great tournament under Gareth Southgate in the World Cup. And a lot was made of those set pieces. Lining up, spinning away. I think they called it, was it the Love Train or something like that?
Yeah.
And I said to Harry, my lad, I said, that's what we did 40 years ago.
Yeah.
At Aston Villa on the opening day. And I'd always thought it was Don Masson that took the corner, but I looked it all up before here. Don wasn't back. He'd come back slightly late.
Yeah.
It was Hooks that had put the ball in. Yeah. But those spins, call it what you will, which at the time was very unusual, but worked a treat. But it's virtually a carbon copy, or what Gareth Southgate did for England at that successful World Cup where we scored from set piece. It's a carbon copy, wasn't it?
And remember that Ian McCulloch wasn't the biggest guy in our team. So there was Killer, there's Trevor Christie. And so at that time, because people hadn't looked at us closely in the division, but now we're in the big league and they haven't had a chance to look at us. So we had surprise on our side. And again, another thing about that is that Ian McCulloch was probably the best in the air in that team in terms of leap, and in terms of timing and direction, and also, where necessary, in terms of courage. So it was a no-brainer, and it didn't matter when Hooksy put that ball down. It didn't matter whether they were top of the league then, bottom of the league then, or what. We were in charge until they got that ball back.
Very good. I'm just going to throw one or two sort of a couple of random moments. You hinted at press conferences. Sunderland away. We drew 1-1. McCulloch lobbed, I think it was Barry Siddle, and Ali McCoyce was playing for Sunderland, and he had a bad time. He couldn't hit a barn door. Finished 1-1, and I blagged a press pass through my journalism college, and it was the first time I'd ever been into a press conference. I'm 18, I'm a journalism student, and I learned more in the about 3.5 minutes that you and Jimmy came in than I did in about 3 years of journalism lecturing, because I'm a student, it's happy families, everything's nice. And I remember you came in with Jimmy. The journalists were there. There was a bottle of scotch. And I think Jimmy came in, got himself a scotch. Questions, gentlemen. And again, I think some of the Northeast journalists incurred Jimmy's wrath. I don't think you said a word. Jimmy basically just absolutely annihilated each question in turn. You know, effing and jeffing and blinding. And he went out, and I thought, God, blimey, they don't teach you that in journalism. And God, blimey. And I thought, it was quite adversarial. Jimmy could be when he wanted to be, couldn't he? And a lot of players have subsequently told me he never, it didn't matter who it was, you couldn't criticise his players.
No. No.
Very protective.
Which is, as I said a while ago, they have to know they can trust you and they have to respect you. Greater love of no man than laying down his life, or being prepared to lay down his life on behalf of you. So when it came to facing up to journalists, Jimmy didn't worry two hoots about what they're going to write about him next week, next Tuesday or whenever, and what they thought about him. He just would blast at them. I don't know whether he thought it through or not, but it certainly was a spanner thrown into the works. To be honest, people have said to me later that maybe I learned too much from him, because a lot of people have said to me, you know, your greatest problem, weren't you? Yeah, go on. Well, PR, you didn't you didn't court journalists. Mm. You weren't the best communicator with them, and so on. A local reporter said to me about 3 months into my reign at Sheffield Wednesday, it just shows you how they remember. He said, "Do you remember what you said to Peter Cooper in that first interview?" I said, "Now what?" He said, "Peter Cooper, after about 15 minutes of the interview, this was me making my debut, stood up and said in that superior way of his that I believe you were a teacher." So I said, "Yes." He said, "And what did you teach?" And I said, "Children." and turned to the next hand, and he sat down, and apparently he took that personally.
Oh yeah,
he took it personally. Yeah. He thought I was being a smart ass, where I didn't think I was being a smart ass. I mean, that's what I thought. I know about PE and French and maths and so on and so forth. So yeah, I did PE and I did do a bit of maths. But basically, it's the children that matter. It's not how much I know, it's how much I can give them or help them. So yeah, so I had a poor teacher in terms of PR, personal PR.
Given my background, we could debate that for hours, but we've already, I'm conscious of your time. There was a seminal moment in the development, if you like, of your Notts County blueprint project. So the kind of, for want of a better phrase, you'll probably disagree with me, total football raddies more or less banned from kicking the ball. Yeah, has to be rolled out. The snows came down. Massive winter. It was like 4 or 5 weeks over Christmas, which meant you couldn't play. And this prompted a kind of re-evaluation from your perspective, correct?
Yeah.
So what was that re-evaluation?
Well, it was simple. We weren't winning enough games and therefore enough points to stay up. And the reason being the division we were now in, they had better coaches, they had better players, and they were making life more difficult for us. And our game, we weren't allowed to play our game. So the passing game was no longer effective. And we were heading for relegation. Then, as you say, as if from God, it started snowing beginning of December. And that was football finished for, I think, 5 weeks. Now, up to that point, I had been starting to reevaluate as we approached the halfway season. You know, I'd been starting to think about, well, what do we do here? I want to stay up. And clearly what we were doing wasn't working. So I'd been thinking about it, and the opportunity came to do it properly. So at the very beginning of that long layoff, and it became apparent that very first weekend that it was going to be a long layoff because of the amount that had fallen and the way the forecasts were. And so I sat them down, the players, and said, "Listen, fellas, what we're doing is not working. We're going to get relegated if we keep doing it. Because we're not suddenly going to get better. Coaches are getting to know what we're trying to do better. They're getting to know what works against us better. We need to change. And here's what I propose. But obviously, I need your buy-in." So, to cut a long story short, as I said, you know, we were in the second division. We'd played possession for position. We now had to work on possession for possession. We had to stop giving the ball away or losing it in our own half and so on and so forth. We needed to go start playing up there. So we went to the opposite almost, but bearing in mind the players we got, which was Raddy, who previously not been allowed to kick the ball unless it was absolutely necessary, was now not allowed to roll the ball or throw the ball. Because we weren't getting out of our own half, let alone getting into their half, into the attacking third. And so that those 4 or 5 weeks, having explained to them what we're going to do and having got their approval to go, let's do this. We worked very, very hard on the new way, which was to play longer from our half, and two things. If we got it in their half, great, we play on from there. If they get it in their half, we work very, very hard at getting the ball back, but in their half. And we recognise that one way or the other, if we do not get the ball into that, what you these days, they have all different names for it, but the killing zone, which is basically from the sides of the six-yard box out to the penalty box. Firstly, the most goals get scored in the middle, around penalty area. The goal area is least, and then this area. So, you know, one way or the other, you see Manchester United, they'll play these days, they're playing 5, 6-a-side, 7-a-side up in the opponent's box. That's the real cream end of that continuum. Whereas, that's fine, but if you can't do that, then you've got to find a way to get it into that area, and you've got to have people in that area when you do. So we went the other way, and we worked hard at it. And other people went away. Forrest was one of the first to go to sunnier climes. And we stayed. I spoke with the groundsman. So at the end of every training session, he would get on it with the tractor and everything else at the university. And he'd again scrape and scrape the snow so it was more of a crumb. Obviously that would freeze, but then the next morning he'd come again with the same cap and then break that crumb up so that we were able to work, not as well as you can do when you've got a nice grass pitch, but we were better able to work at that. And there was an immediate change of fortune. And I think points per game from that period, when we started in January, I think it was first week, we doubled our points per game compared with the other end. So you get to the end of the season and ask the players, so what do you think about that? Their thought is, Notts County, not the highest payers in the world. We could have been in the second division, back on second division money, but we're not. We're in the first division and we're on first division money. So hey ho. Let other people think and say what they will, but we start next season in this division.
Nottingham Forest, Brian Clough. Now you pulled out two blinding results. Forest had won the European Championship the previous season. It would have been one of the first games after that winter break. It was rearranged because both teams had been knocked out in the third round of the FA Cup. Remember it like this yesterday. Gone to the City Ground. Now, for Notts County fans who've lived in the shadow of Forest for God knows how long, this was we would view it as a seminal moment because we kind of came out of the shadow. Yeah? What's it like from a manager's perspective? Is it just another victory? Is it spicier? I can recount it like yesterday, 0-0. John Robertson, who didn't miss many penalties. He didn't miss many. Raddy dived to his right, put his hand on it, saved it. We went on to win 2-0. Great day from Notts fans of that era that will always remember that day.
Yeah. And of course, it's I've talked a lot about it's not that game, it's the next game and so on and so forth. But obviously a local derby you cannot, as it were, treat that like any other game, even if you try. It was huge, that result, huge. And a funny story emerged from it, which sort of tells you what a paradox Brian could be sometimes. So after the game, he wasn't very, chummy.
He took it bad, did he? He didn't like losing.
Well, no, but you could tell it was smarting. We've got an away game after that, around a month after. We've got an away game, and I'm walking along the embankment with my suit bag. You know, you carry your suit in. So I've got my tracksuit on. I've got that. And I'm just walking along the embankment because at that point, I've got a house, as it were, off the embankment, a small development they put there, very cheap, low-cost housing, and that's where the house was. So I was walking to the ground to get on the bus. And I'm walking along the side of the Trent, and this big car slowly pulls up in the pavement just ahead of me. And as I get level with it, the window's coming down. And I'm not paying any attention at all, but as I get level with the door, I hear, "Hey, big head." So I look in, and it's Brian. He said, "Can't you afford a car and the money they pay you? Get in." I said, no, you're all right. It's only 100 yards away. You know what? I'm at the bridge. Get in. I said, "No, you're all right." He said, "Get in." So he drives to the ground. And I said, "Yeah, fine here, Brian. Drop me here. I'll get out of the car and I'll walk into the ground through the gates." He drives into the ground with me in the car. So his players getting out of their cars. And I'm driving in the car, sitting in the front seat with Brian Clough, who does a three-point turn, stops outside the player's entrance, and there's a player going in, opens the door, and said, "Cheerio." And so I get out of the car, and he drives off. He thought that were all very funny.
Jimmy had a very good relationship with Cloughy, didn't he? They got on well, didn't they?
Oh, very well. Yeah, very well. Very well. Because Jimmy was Jimmy. So Jimmy spoke the same way to everybody. And Jimmy would talk to Brian Clough as if Jimmy had just won the European Championship. And in between that, he'd won the First Division. And in the summer, he'd gone away and won the World Cup. No sense of inferiority complex with Jimmy, with anybody, and in particular with Brian. And I think Brian respected the fact that, again, as I say, that phrase, if you're not afraid to think it, don't be afraid to say it. And you know that certainly was Jimmy.
What other game to mention from that season you stayed up in the top flight? And there's a certain irony with what you've said earlier about going slightly longer ball. Ipswich Town, which again, it was on the telly. Thankfully, it was on Anglia telly. So we've all been able to watch it down the years again. You know, how good a goal was that?
Well, don't forget, the longer ball was a solution to our predicament at the time. But that's not to say that on those occasions when the opportunity presented itself, you didn't use the strengths that hitherto you had been able to capitalise on. So, and that's a good thing about good coaching and intelligent players, that they recognise that there's our methods, but in between that, they also recognise the times when you know, they do what they can do. So on this occasion, we're away at Ipswich, and the opportunity arises, and we revert back to winning the ball back in our half and finishing up with a goal up at the other end after making, I can't remember, you've probably got it written down somewhere, was it 18 passes or?
Yeah, Brady threw it out, a whole six, and they weren't just passes, they were one-touch passes, if I remember right. They all first touch from one end of the pitch to the other. Put the ball in the net, Gordon Mayer.
On the break, they never touched the ball. And it was such a good goal that at half-time, as we get up to go inside, Bob's waiting for me, walking up to where he stood at the dugout. Puts his arm around my shoulder, shakes my hand, and eulogises about the goal.
So this is the England manager, Bobby Robson, saying to, I don't know, would you call yourself an apprentice of his, but saying, well done.
Yeah. He was, that was a good thing about Bobby. He was, if you liked and respected you, he was top man.
So one season,
he could always keep in touch. I mean, when he went to Spain, he'd ring me probably every second Sunday night. Just to talk about what had gone on. He rang me to ask about Chapman. Lee Chapman, he asked me about him as a player. And I remember, and I'll be quick, I said, Bob, you know, was he in Portugal? I think it was Portugal, was it?
He was in Portugal. He was at Sporting, wasn't he?
Yeah. So he rings about Chapman. I said, well, Bob, honestly, he will score goals. You get the ball into the penalty area, into the, you know, second 6-yard box, he'll score goals, undoubtedly. I said, but, you know, I'm not so sure about how he'll fit in Portugal and this and that and the other. And they were doing well. And he said, yeah, well, he said, that's why I want him. He said, because they have it, we have it. They have it, we have it. And sometimes something might come of it, he might not. And when it might not, I'm just wondering whether if I get him, put him on the bench, and on those occasions when that's, you know, the story where it's come a bit stalemate, I chuck him on, we get the ball in the box, he scores, and everybody goes home happy. And that's Bob. You know, he would say he had beliefs, but again, you've got to be practical at the same time.
No.
And that was Bob being practical, thinking, what can I do about this? How can I make it into an advantage? And that was an idea he came up with. Because Chapman at that time had... I mean, Chapman, he had his best periods with me. Wherever else he went.
In Leeds, yeah?
Yeah, he didn't. He couldn't. He wasn't. Because basically, he didn't get the service. And... that's what he understood when he came down to Sheffield Wednesday. I explained to him that I asked him which areas are you in when you score? And what did you do before? And so on. Go on, think about it. And he thought about it and he told me. And I just said, this was in me trying to persuade him to come to Sheffield Wednesday from Sunderland. Well, I'll tell you what, I'll guarantee you that this team will put the ball in that area a minimum of 10 times a game. Mm. I'll guarantee you that. Now, if I did that, or if that was happening every game, Chappie, and there were decent balls, how many goals do you think you'd score? He said, 3. I said, I think you're being a bit optimistic there. I'd go near a 1, possibly two, 1.5. But I said, so I'm saying that to you. You'll get that on average. One game in two at least, and probably more. So think about that in goal terms. And he got it. He's an intelligent lad, and he got it. So then at half time, lots of times I'd come in and he'd be doing the team talk because he'd be having a go at wide player. About, what are you doing? You had a chance to put it in one touch early. Instead of Richie's check, come out, I've got a check. And so, yeah.
So you've one season down, and you had another very successful season by keeping Notts in that division. We've talked a lot about tactics, but you were very much at the forefront of, I don't know, I always use the word appliance of science, yeah? But the diet, yeah? I think you dug out home Pierpont. Using students from Nottingham University and Vantage Point, where you had a special access built on top of the old stand. So you were clearly very much trying to look into your crystal ball. And a lot of the things you bought in at Notts have kind of now developed into industries within football in their own right. I mean, just talk me through, you know, you were presumably soaking up new information and new practices.
When I finished at Brian, I went to Boston. I also became a student at Sheffield Teacher Training College, Sheffield University, for PE. And during that course, and of course, being keen and working with the FA on various things, statistics were starting to emerge as a part to contribute towards success. And on top of that, I started to learn about diet, hydration, and so on and so forth. Athletics were getting more into diet and training scientifically. And stats, which had been around a long time. In fact, Stan Cullis was one of the first to be successful using stats. I decided that statistical analysis would support good decision-making from my point of view. So I went to Nottingham University, spoke to the appropriate people and said, look, free tickets for a game. If at the same time when you come to the game, you'll you'll record stats based on what you see occurring during the game. And they weren't complicated stats. They were entries into the attacking third, strikes on target and so on, set pieces. Not complicated. And then obviously diet became important. And as soon as I got there, you know, I said, what are we doing before the game Saturday? There's a place down at home Pierpont I've discovered in my secret visits, and they've got a restaurant and they're willing to have us for pre-match, and I want a diet that's in line with effective performance. So the choice would be, and so the steak went, etc. and you know, it's carbohydrates and so on. And from my point of view, in terms of seeing the game, the dugout at Notts was not the best dugout at that time.
No.
I asked Jimmy and he indicated that there was a position in the top of the stand, which was reached by a wall ladder on the outside of the stand, and that was over the dugout. So I decided I'd go up there first half, which meant me climbing up this ladder, then getting along the rafters and then sitting in this area underneath the stand roof above the dugout, which gave me a perfect view for 44, 44 or 43 of the 45 minutes. That's why, because then I was off and down to be in the dressing room when they came in with the stats and so on. And also, during that time, I decided that effective communication between me and Jimmy was absolutely essential. So if there was anything really, really crucial cropped up whilst I was up there, I'd write that down on a piece of paper and wrap it round one of the pebbles that I'd taken up with me and sling that down onto the trike.
Yeah. For our younger viewers, mobile phones were not invented at this point.
No. So, you've got to think outside the box now and again.
I mean, if statistics, vantage point, very much you were looking to try and give yourself an edge or a little bit of an advantage by adopting other things, because man for individual man, you're not going to be able to go and sign Ian Rush, are you? You know?
No. So you have to accumulate success in areas which hitherto hadn't seemed to matter. So it was try to take every opportunity to add to your chances of success. Nutrition's crucial. Now, everybody knows that, but not necessarily at that time. Not just on game day, but throughout the week. So effective diet, I mean, by the time I got to Leeds United, we were having tests on. I was getting tests on players so that it could be worked out which was the best drink to rehydrate them. So all the drinks were the same, but there were variations in each individual, and so a drink was prepared that tried to cater with any variations that they might have outside of the ordinary. It's just, you know, accumulation of small advantages. That's all that you're looking for. Eventually the players buy into it and it becomes second nature to them, and then they start to moan if they don't get it.
As if running Notts County wasn't enough, I think I'm right in saying, you had another job, didn't you? You were manager of England under 21s.
I was assisting.
Assistant.
Yeah, Dave Sexton.
You were assistant, sorry. Because Brian Kilcline was in the under 21s, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And Brian tells a lovely story. Because of his dad's Irish patronage, Brian's dad was desperate for him to play for the Republic, who kept knocking on the door. And when you'd had conversations with Brian, you would tell him, you're going to play for England under 21s.
Yeah.
And I said to Brian, okay, well, you know, sometimes your dad's a really strong influencer. He goes, well, yeah. He said, but I always did what Howard told me. Which I thought was, you know, this 6'4" colossus, he's got his old man saying, you're going to play for Ireland. I always did what Howard told me.
Yeah. Well, that's why I say to people, respect and trust is critical. It's absolutely critical, because if you've got that, you can advise where necessary, but also in addition to advise, you can also say, if you do this, you'll be better for it. And maybe sometimes you can't always give a full explanation that's, as it were, someone grasps straight away. They, you know, without saying it, there are times when you have to say, look, just trust me. And that you have to know that the answer to that is yes. even though you're not asking him, that it's on that basis that he does trust you, that you're able sometimes to tell. You know, it's very necessary to sell, but there are moments sometimes when it's necessary to tell. Time can be a factor. So at the half time, there's times when you can't really spend 20 minutes on a point. You just got to be able to say something, and he's got to accept that and trust you.
How good was Brian Killer? Because it was probably a bit of a leap of faith on your part. I mean, because you put him in when he was basically 17 years old. Mm. And he just played every game, didn't he, more or less?
Yeah. Well, he had enormous physical advantages for starters. He was also, he had football intelligence. He was quick. He had all the basics, really. All the basics. And a huge, I mean, some people are big or tall, but some people are big and tall. And he was the latter. He was a man at 17 in terms of his physicality. And he was quick and nimble and decent with the ball. In fact, I'm sure I remember him maybe starting as a striker.
He did. When he came into Notts, he was a centre forward. Yeah.
Yeah.
And couldn't score. And he nearly got released by Notts because he'd bullied, if you like, people at 15 in schools and all of that sort of thing. Mm. And then when he became an apprentice, it wasn't working. Mm. Couldn't score.
So, yeah, it was a no-brainer. And as far as I was concerned, I can't think of a game when he actually let you down or didn't come up to scratch. No.
Trevor Christie said, in his entire professional career, he was a very good goal threat for us, wasn't he, in that final third. He said he was never, ever fitter than when you were manager at Notts.
Again, it was marginal gains. You have to get the players whereby you can not only tell but sell. And what I'd like to think that every club I've been at is that I have been able to get that over to the players, get them to recognise how important it was. So Vinnie Jones at Leeds United was a prime example of that. Gordon Strachan said he'd never been fitter than he was at Leeds United. And it became part of the culture there. It wasn't different. It was from walking into to Leeds United on the first day and seeing what they were having for lunch. By the second day, it had all changed. I'd had the kitchen staff in and I'd explained to them that I didn't think they were bad cooks. I just thought they were cooking bad food. And that from now on, we're going to go down the healthy diet road. And same travelling away. There was a point where a sports scientist was saying that the best time to re-energize in terms of food was immediately after performance. So there was a point where you were trying to get the players to eat a chocolate bar or something or other in the dressing room after a game. And then that was you know, shown to be not as effective as this and so on. And then you moved on and moved on where Arsene Wenger at Arsenal introduced, if you like, psychological physical mapping, where to the point where players when they woke up in the morning on their mobile phones, had to fill in a form with that, which had questions in it, always the same questions. And that had to go into the club. And it, all that had to be done before a certain time, let's call it 8:15, so that by the time they got in the club, the sports support staff, that's sports medicine, sports science, etc., could look at all that and have an ongoing build-up in order to make sure that by the time they arrive at the club for training, all these things have been, as it were, noted and put back into the file. So there's a, and out of that came the ability to say, if you're there at a club long enough, that look, this, what we're seeing here is that this player is the yardage he's covering, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But within margins, there's a point where we're recommending you need to rest him for your good and for his good. He needs to have a week free or whatever. So it's just become run of the mill now. It's
last expected. Conscious of your time. So two seasons under your belt, and you've kept Notts relatively, I say easily, but relatively straightforward. There wasn't a great escape needed or anything like that in the last four matches to stay up. So you've got a very young team, people like Trevor Christie, young 20s, Goodwin, Hunt, Hooks, Mayer. You know, not many of these players were past 25. Graham Taylor, round about this time, was building his dynasty at Watford. If you had stayed on at Notts, you know, do you think you could have built, you know, Notts into a sort of a, you know, 8th, 9th, 10th position place club? Because you got 2 15th places in your first 2 years there.
I think in time, yes. But that would have meant deeper discussions with the chairman about finance, because as Graham found out at Watford, you know, there is a point where forget everything else. There's a point where sometimes only money will solve. That player would do us and improve us by 5% or whatever, but he'll cost this. So there has to be that ability to do that the higher up you go, because the higher up you go, the more the qualities of the players matter. So yes, it's possible, but it's difficult, but it can be done, as Watford showed, especially if you've got money behind you eventually. Yes. It would have been possible.
Because again, I think a lot of people thought it was your almost destiny as a Sheffield boy to go to Sheffield Wednesday. But as you've said before, in an abbreviated version, you weren't actively looking to get away from Notts at that point, and it was more by accident than, you know, coveting something else to move on from Notts. Correct? No, you weren't unhappy at Notts at that point.
No. It was. I was at East Midlands Airport when somebody said, I think it was East Midlands. Yeah, there's a phone call for you going away. And it was the chairman of Sheffield Wednesday. And the reason I listened to that call was because I sat down with Jack at the end of that season, and he was talking to me about a new contract. And as always with Jack Dunnett, Mr. Dunnett, we had a difference of opinion as to my value and his. So in the end, the difference was £1,000.
Was that what it was?
But it wasn't £1,000 in 350 or 400,000. It was £1,000 in double figures, lower double figures. And so I left to go on holiday and left the contract business like that because of our, you know, Jack's refusal to say, yeah, he'd reconsider.
So the sticking plaster there is a fact, or sticking point is £1,000.
Yeah.
So if that £1,000 Jack had crumbled, which he never did in negotiations, we know. Yeah. But if he had, you would have signed that contract and you wouldn't have been going to Sheffield Wednesday.
No, that's right. Yeah. However, Sheffield Wednesday did come calling.
Yeah.
And the chairman was very persuasive, and eventually I went up to see him and two for other directors. They asked me to give my thoughts to them about a possible move and future. And as with Sheffield Wednesday were like Leeds in the same manner, that what I said made sense to them and they were happy to recognise the fact that money mattered and can accelerate progress.
Yeah.
And the position they were in was Jack had taken them up and they'd done very well, and then the season he left, they hadn't done so well. But I know that in those days, Sheffield Wednesday could support over 30,000 fans, yeah, if things were going well. And at that time, gates mattered in terms of revenue.
Yeah.
So, and it came with disadvantages, but it was a blank piece of paper. It was to start from scratch in many respects.
And of course, you're dropping down a division to go to Sheffield Wednesday at this point as well, aren't you?
Yeah, it was the same with Leeds. Yeah.
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 I find it, you can never ever criticise Jack Dunnett for what he achieved at Notts County. No. But for £1,000, Jack would have effectively guaranteed a minimum of one. And you're a very honourable man. So if that was a 2-year contract, I would have suggested 2 years of
it was 2 years, yeah.
In the top, of Notts competing in the top flight. Because you never had a team relegated. Okay.
No.
You had those Notts County promoted into the top flight, achieved their best placing God knows decades. Sheffield Wednesday promoted, got them highest for a long time. Leeds got them up, won the title. So, as track records go, there are none better than that. Put into context for me, it's what my son told me to ask you, so he's learning a bit of journalistic nous now. Put into context what you achieved at Notts County compared to Sheffield Wednesday and compared to Leeds.
Oh, it was... if you put it like that, Notts County was Notts County was the most difficult because of when you put into the pot all the requirements for success, and I mean that in a 360 degree sense. Then in the long term and in the short term, really, success at Notts County to first division level, or as it's called now, the Premier League, was just Everything's against you. History, crowds, finances, stadium, training facilities. By that I mean modern training facilities. It was just we tricked our way to promotion by having a surprising way of playing. Sheffield Wednesday was actually the same, and because of what was at my disposal, for the first time possibly in England, we played with three at the back. We played with a very high line. Offside was a big factor in what we did. We had three strikers up front, two midfielders. The strikers were asked to do the work of three strikers, as it were, becoming two defenders. We were very, very fit. We played a very, very high tempo, very high tempo. And we had a way of playing that suited what we got at the time, because when I got there, I found that the squad was very imbalanced in terms of players and positions and so on and so forth. But they were in the second division and Jack had done quite well with them, and they hadn't done so well in his last season. But I knew that the future could be brighter because of the crowds, which at that time was very important in generating revenue. So we did finish up with in a stadium with 30,000 people in, and that brought the revenue in. Leeds was different in the sense that, to summarise Leeds, I said no at first because they were bottom of the first, second division, and Sheffield Wednesday were about fifth in the first division. I said no, and I said no about five times. But the chairman was so persuasive. And eventually I gave in and said, yeah, I will come up and see you. And it was like that. All right, I'll come up and see you. So I went up to see him, and I found myself attracted by his modesty. He was a very successful businessman. His grandparents had come here from Russia. He joined the RAF in the war, came out of the RAF, got a loan from the RAF, started making paint in a garage. He finished up with the factory, which he sold for millions. And at that time, Leeds United were in debt and all sorts of things. Anyway, I must have had four or five meetings with him. By the end of it, we'd worked out I'd proposed and produced for him a plan for 10 years at Leeds, which saw us into the first division, established, looking at Champions League, a new training ground, which we got, an academy, what's called academies now. We had one at Leeds, because when we built the training ground, we put accommodation on it and we paired our boys with a school so they could go to school during the day and train in the evenings with us and stay in the accommodation with a housemaster and mistress. And that was a long-term plan hatched in during five meetings after dark in his factory, in his office, with only him in the factory. He was locking the door when we left. And at the end of it, I said to him, well, so there you are. There's a quick way to doing this, and there's a slow way. Bearing in mind, there was second bottom in the second division. And he said, what's the difference? I said, you have to make available to me over the next 3 years, £3 million. And I know that's going to be your money, because I know we don't own the ground. And I know that you are, the club is subsistence on you at the moment. So, you know, that's what you've got to do, having gone through all our meetings and talks and having agreed what it is we might do if unexpectedly I did say yes, I will come to Leeds. And it was, that was the basis of that, the plan was a 10-year plan, but unfortunately it only lasted, I think, 7 years, because he and his wife had a violent robbery, burglars, which was life-threatening, and it knocked him. And at the same time, club was starting to go corporate, and there was an offer for the club from a company, I forget the name now. And when the club accepted that takeover, I became aware that they'd got George Graham lined up to take my position when they signed. But the chairman and another was still fighting for me to stay at the club. So I had to go through pre-season and the start of the season knowing that this was highly unlikely. But the players knew it as well. I didn't know it until afterwards that they knew it. And hence, I remember, I think it was the second game we played away at Blackburn, and we beat them. And I walked in the dressing room at the end and I thought we just won the FA Cup, because the players were so delighted with the result and with what they thought might be a possible outcome. But it wasn't to be.
Final question. And really, it's been a fantastic, I think it's the best part of 3 hours. So thank you very much indeed. And, you know, you gave us the best, for people of my generation, you gave us the best years of watching Notts County by a country mile.
Thank you very much.
The final question. Last words, I think, should be on Jimmy Sirrel. What did you learn from Jimmy? What did you take away from Jimmy? How did that relationship stand you in future stead at Sheffield Wednesday and Leeds?
Well, this is not a summary, but the first thing was, if you're not afraid to think it, don't be afraid to say it. So when if you talk to Jimmy, it is a frank discussion. And I learned that that is often, in fact, mostly the best way. Secondly, I was, his humility in as it were, accepting the position that I came there, in the sense it was he who had decided that I would be the person to come there and help him and them. So it was he that would have persuaded the chairman. And he was true to his word when I got there. He did leave a lot of it to me. He did take a lot of the, if you like, the stuff that was at the edges, even jokingly to writing the team sheet out and so on. And he did always have my back in the nicest possible way, so that he would often say, no, listen, it's my honest opinion that it's better that you go home tonight and let me go and watch that game. You go home, get your feet up and concentrate on what you're going to do tomorrow. And as it were, re-energising. And all that came from a very, very, very humble upbringing. Working, I think I'm right in saying, in the docks in Glasgow. His time in the Merchant Navy in the war, when he was on convoys. In fact, that was one of his favourite sayings that I still remember now. If he was making a judgment on people, his judgment would be based on, would I want him in the lifeboat with me? And that's how you were judged. If he'd welcomed you in his lifeboat when the ship was going down, you were okay. But if you weren't welcome in his lifeboat because of what he thought of you, then it was look after yourself. And his sometimes his intuitive thinking was good. I remember being away at West Ham and it was half time, I think we were three down. In the second, he came down and just after half time, and he sat on the bench and shuffled up next to me on the bench. And I was sat there wanting to say, well, what would you do? And thinking, and he never said anything. And I said, in the end, I said, what do you think? He said, if I were you, I'd start, tell the driver to start the bus. In other words, look, some things you just have to accept. Get on the bus and go home. And start again.
Howard, absolute pleasure, absolute privilege, wonderful, wonderful times. Thank you for taking the time to share a real insight into to what went on and how you achieved what has been largely unparalleled success at Notts County for over 80 or 90 years. So thank you very much indeed.
Very, very kind of you to say so. Thank you very much.